Welcome to the 14th video of Quantum Mechanics Done Right, the shortest path from novice to researcher. In this video, we're going to be talking about Chapter 9, which discusses angular momentum and spin. Angular momentum is all about rotations, and one of the key things about rotations is they don't commute. Here we're showing you an example. If you took a book and you rotated it 90 degrees about one axis and then 90 degrees about another axis, and then you change the order in which you did those rotations, you find you get to a different final state. This shows that rotations don't commute with each other. That makes them a non-abelian group. And there's a lot of consequences of that. That means the different components of angular momentum, when we think of them as operators, don't commute with each other, and so forth. One of the important places to get to when you talk about angular momentum is to get to the spherical harmonics, and I'm illustrating for you here what the spherical harmonics look like for the S, P, and D shells using a graphic that is both showing you via the grayscale the phase of the spherical harmonic and the amplitude as well. All right, Chapter 9, Angular Momentum and Spin. We cover rotations. We cover states of definite, total, and z component of angular momentum. We look at how you combine or add angular momentum together. We bring back and discuss the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen experiment and entangled states of spin in the Bohm variant. We derive spherical harmonics. And we also discuss Schwinger's representation in terms of the simple harmonic oscillator in two dimensions. It's a really interesting way of looking at angular momentum from a completely different perspective than the traditional way of looking at angular momentum. All right, let's go browse through the chapter. Our quote for this chapter comes from Barack Obama, the 44th President of the United States and also a Nobel laureate. Keep exploring, keep dreaming, keep asking why. Don't settle for what you already know. Never stop believing in the power of your ideas, your imagination, your hard work to change the world. So we first start in talking about angular momentum in looking at the commutation relations of the position operators and the momentum operators with angular momentum, and we find that they take the same form, and it's the form of a vector operator. And vector operators rotate under angular momentum, and that is one of the aspects that is particularly interesting, because knowing that you have this general commutation relation of vector operators then allows you to kind of jump to a lot of different results when you're working with vector operators and you're having to do commutation relations with angular momentum, such as if you're applying a rotation operator, you know that the vector operator will get rotated by that rotation operator. And so you can work out the results of the commutation relation or the results of applying that operator to a vector operator. So it's useful to understand this general result of a vector operator, and we prove it explicitly for both position and momentum in this first section. And it turns out angular momentum itself is a vector operator, and that's in many sense a confusing thing, because we tend to think of operators as commuting with themselves, and when they're the same thing, they do. But as we mentioned, different components of angular momentum don't actually commute with themselves. So then we go in to discuss how the fact that we have these vector operators relates to the idea of rotations, and here you see that image that I showed at the beginning of the video. This equation 920 is the equation for a rotation about an axis located in the EN director, EN being a unit vector, and I'm rotating by an angle of alpha about that angle. So there are a number of different things that you can work out related to vector operators using our Hadamard lemma and showing that it actually corresponds to rotations. We first work it out in the different axes, and then we show that it works for the general rotation as well. Then our next subsection is looking at the states that have definite angular momentum. Because the square of angular momentum commutes with each of its components, but the components don't commute with themselves, we can find states that have a definite L squared value and have a definite value of LZ. We could have also picked LX or LY, but it's traditional to pick LZ as the one that we're going to work with. And we then have to do some abstract algebra to figure out what the properties of these states are that have definite angular momentum L and definite Z component of angular momentum M. This is a very standard quantum mechanics exercise. You'll find it in nearly all quantum mechanics textbooks. We don't do anything different here from the way it's done everywhere else. And as we move into the fourth section of the chapter, there's a number of problems that we give for this because there's a lot of interesting physical problems. You saw rotations of buckyballs and rotations of molecules, and then there's some interesting math identities that you get with these states. So there's a lot of interesting problems that you have here. Then we move on to our next big topic, which is addition of angular momentum. Again, everything we do here is very standard, similar to the way it's done in other quantum mechanics textbooks. You have two independent angular momentum, and you are working with states that are tensor product states that combine both angular momentum. And it turns out that you can describe things in terms of the total angular momentum, in addition to thinking about describing them just in terms of the individual angular momentum. And there's some rules that you have to go through about how the different Z components of angular momentum vary as you look at applying raising and lowering operators to them. And there are diagrams like the one in that figure that help you work that out. You have some counting exercises to make sure you got all of the states and so forth. This is what I tend to call a French cooking kind of chapter and French cooking kinds of calculations. No step is particularly hard, but there are lots of steps, and you got to go through all the steps to get everything right. We have a number of problems to describe how this works because it's important for you to understand how angular momentum is combined when we get into the next chapter where we talk about different kinds of spin models and how the spin models work. Then our next section is on entangled states, the Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox, and the Bell experiments. The key thing here is that a singlet state looks the same no matter what axis you express the singlet state in, and that is a theorem that we prove in this chapter. And then we go ahead and we discuss the EPR experiment, and we explain it now using our Dirac notation, and we can do the calculations for what the results are for these different Bell experiments. And it really puts the work that we had done earlier in chapter 2 on a much firmer and rigorous mathematical basis. There really isn't anything new here. You actually already know all about the Bell experiments. But by working now with the operators, we can get much more quantitative. And instead of our telling you what the rules are that you have to follow, which is what we did in Chapter 2, here we show you how you can derive them just from the commutation relations of the operators and the properties of the states that we're working with. Then we have some additional discussions about angular momentum states. Here we're looking at how you can generate states of arbitrary total spin and a constructive fashion in which you construct them, which is shown in this figure, where you start from one spin state, then go to 2, then to 3, then to 4, and in a systematic fashion, you eventually can figure out all of the possible states of n spins. And the number that you have that have different values of total spin is not something that's an easy formula that you can just work out, but by working through things like this diagram and knowing how you combine spin 1/2 to a state that already has some higher value of spin allows you to think about the different features of how you do this construction and how to count and learn what the different numbers of states are. So that's a very useful exercise that we're going to use in the next chapter. And now we've gotten to section 9.7, spherical harmonics. This is one of my favorite derivations in the entire textbook. This is a derivation that took me a long time to figure out. I worked with a citizen scientist, Mark Weitzman, on this problem. And what is nice about it is if you've ever taken a conventional quantum mechanics class, the derivation of spherical harmonics is just absolutely tortuous. You first have to start with the Laplacian. You have to rewrite it in spherical coordinates. You have to separate out the angular parts. Then you have to play with changing the functional form that you're going to operate the spherical, the angular part of the Laplacian onto to eventually massage it into the form of a Legendre differential equation, and then you get the solutions or Legendre polynomials, which you're often just told what they are and go look them up kind of a thing, as opposed to actually deriving them from the differential equation. On the other hand, here we take a very physical perspective, recognizing that a wave function is the overlap of two different quantum states. So it is asking how much of the state that is a position state at the angle theta and phi is in the eigenstate that has total angular momentum L and z component of angular momentum m. When you think about it that way, it then leads to a physical construction which says, how do I get the state theta phi? Well, we get that by starting at the North Pole, rotating by an angle theta about the y-axis, and then rotating by an angle phi about the z-axis. And so the spherical harmonic is really looking at the overlap of that North Pole state with these two rotation operators, which then act on the LM state. Now, because the LM states are eigenstates of the LZ operator, the first factor can be just evaluated because it's an eigenstate and pulled out. The second factor, we have to use our exponential disentangling identity to evaluate it. And then what we find is we have to expand the part for the raising and the lowering operators. And those are finite polynomials that truncate. And then we have to look at what is the action of them. They will raise, but then after they raise each term, we have to lower the term exactly to the state with m equals zero. And we have to add up all possible ways that I could raise and I can lower. And lo and behold, when you add all of those up, you get the spherical harmonics. So yes, it does have a fair amount of algebra to it, but the hardest thing is actually figuring out how to relate it to the spherical harmonics. Then you can look at how to act L pluses and L minuses on states. When you think of the angular momentum state as being constructed out of an even number of spin one-half operators. Now, this might seem like an odd thing to do, but this is the way Wigner liked to work with angular momentum. Reduce everything down to working with n spin operators and then work out all the algebra because it could be worked out exactly with regards to those n spin operators. In particular, this is the way an object called the rotation matrix is evaluated, and that is something that we do here. So we get that nice picture of spherical harmonics. There's a lot of algebra that we have to work through. And I have you go through a number of exact calculations with spin one to really verify that all of the different identities that we worked out actually hold. And then we get to our final section of the chapter, which is Schwinger's representation of angular momentum. Here's a nice picture of Schwinger from the 1950s. Or early 1960s, it says. And what he did was he showed how you can map angular momentum onto a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. It's a really neat construction. The interesting story behind this is he worked this out for the government, and it was part of a Office of Naval Research report, I believe. And so people who wanted to learn about it, he never published it in any kind of a journal, so people who wanted to get a copy of it had to send him a letter and say, can you please email me a copy of that report? And I'm sure he very happily had his secretary make off a copy and send it out to whoever made the request. Now it has been published as a Dover publication. It's a very inexpensive Dover publication. I highly recommend it if you want to get an idea about how this works. He gives much more detail than what I give in this section of the chapter. But what I give you in here really gives you all of the meat so you can understand exactly how that works. It's a very cool way of thinking about angular momentum. It is, again, one of these French cooking things, so you can see there's lots of equations involved in this chapter. None of them are particularly hard, but you have to be careful and sit down and work through them. The interesting thing that comes out of this is you actually get a ladder operator that allows you to change the total angular momentum as opposed to just raising or lowering the z component of angular momentum. And that's a construction that you don't often see. It's not clear exactly how useful that operator is. I haven't found a need to use it in any of the calculations or work that I've done, but it is an interesting thing that comes up in this chapter itself. So that's all for chapter 9. Hey guys, let's do quantum right.